All right. Well, thanks. Well, it's a great honor to be here, and I appreciate General Rapp and inviting me back. This is actually a particularly interesting group to talk to because of the diversity of the folks here in the audience. Last year, I had the honor of speaking at your graduation exercise, which I think is Friday. My battle buddy, Abe Abrams, will be speaking with you. So it's good to be invited back. In fact, this time is better because last time there was a constant sound of about 350 car engines running as I was speaking at graduation, as people were making sure they were Redcon 1, and so I wasn't sure I had their undivided attention. So at least this is a little bit more of a controlled environment in here. Well, I'm going to talk to you today about a number of things. It's great to see some old friends in here. Ambassador Jeffries, great American and leader who had to put up with me in Iraq, and so you can blame him, the fact that I still have a life here in the Army. But I'm going to talk about some larger issues and then kind of zoom into some specific issues and then open it up for Q&A because I find I get a lot out of it just because the questions you ask me give me insight into maybe things that are clear or not clear, et cetera. So I spent a lot of time talking to folks in the Army. Just a couple days ago, I was down at Fort Leavenworth talking to the pre-command course, those that are about to take battalion and brigade command to speak with them. This afternoon, I'll talk over at the CJ Flick course. And one of the things I talk to folks, especially if they're going to a leadership position, it says one thing that leaders have to do is contextualize the environment that they're in, you know, paint the big picture, give the larger visualization so that then when you kind of zero in on what you want to talk about in specifically or what your organization is doing, it helps contextualize that activity within the larger scope. It's amazing how many times I go around the Army, actually at various levels that I've served and explained to folks maybe some of the big picture, and invariably the first question is, well, I didn't know that. I wish somebody had told me that before. Now that actually clears up a lot. So I find I came in to be the TRADOC commander, kind of going through that process, kind of articulating the big picture, et cetera, and going around, a couple of things kind of jumped out at me. And so we have a great joint multinational audience here. So going around speaking to the other elements of the joint team in the U.S. military, first of all, I found out, you know, only the Army has a TRADOC. None of the other services have a TRADOC. The things that TRADOC does are done by those services. They're done a little bit differently. And actually, none of the other armies in the world that I would spend time with have a TRADOC per se like we do. So, of course, that begs the, because, of course, that introduced me here is, you know, Dave Perkins, a TRADOC guy, and people are like, well, what's a TRADOC, you know, what is TRADOC, how do you spell TRADOC, et cetera. And then I found out, like, nobody else has one. So it does beg the question, is everybody else wrong and only the U.S. Army has figured it out, or am I merely excess overhead? Now, you don't need to answer that publicly, at least now, but it does beg a good question. And so I started peeling the onion back. Now, in fact, worked with General Rapp and his team a lot on talent management, and we're trying to figure out how we develop strategic leaders. And one of his, we want people have a, I use the term broad range of assignments, maybe a broadening job. This is my first job in TRADOC headquarters, so this is my broadening job, okay? It's also a culture and foreign language learning experience, being here in TRADOC. And so I started figuring out, well, let's figure out what this is, because everyone asks what's a TRADOC, et cetera. And so I have found, again, and I talked to soon-to-be commanders about this, an important, I think, intellectual exercise to go through is to focus on, first of all, what are you for before you decide what to do? Most people in organizations focus on what they do. We all have a to-do list, right? We have one at work. I have one at home. My one at home is larger than the one at work because I spend less time going after it. But we all have a to-do list, but how many of us have a what-are-we-for list? But I find actually that's the more important question to ask, especially when I first came into TRADOC and would go around all the various aspects of TRADOC. And what do you, and I sort of, the new commander, he's going to come down, we got to give him a briefing. What do you think they briefed me on? What they did. hey, sir, welcome to Fort Benning. We train infantrymen, we train armor, we have Ranger School, we have Airborne School. Welcome to Fort Huachuca, Intel, blah, blah, like that, UAV, et cetera. I mean, they do a lot, but the problem is that doesn't necessarily clarify what you are for. And so I just offer that out in general, that it's a good construct to go through to focus on what are you for before you decide what you're going to do, because then what you get to do is grade what you are doing to see if it's moving you in the direction to accomplish what you are for. So one of the organizations that I've looked at and others have looked at to kind of get a sensing of that, and we took a look at the Army, said, well, the Army, we're a large organization, 1.2 million people when you add all cohorts in. We're in over 160 countries of the world. Every now and then we open up a branch office in another country. We kind of franchise. Sometimes we're invited, sometimes we're not. Our operating budget this year will be about $130-140 billion, so we're a multi-hundred-billion-dollar operation, millions of people, et cetera. So very complex, international, multi-billion-dollar corporation or organization. So I said, let's look at other examples like that. So one of the places went out looked was Google, okay? Tried to kind of get a little bit outside the box to look at other organizations to say, have they gone through the same intellectual process. Of course, in Google, you know, it's neat, it's cutting edge, it's high tech, they have beanbag chairs, they have great chow in the cafeteria, so, you know, why not look at Google? And spent some time with their leadership, vice president out there and others, and they really actually have done a very good job of determining, this is sort of my lexicon, what are they for, then enlightens them as to what they do. Does anyone know what, I think they use their vision statement or mission statement, anyone know what Google's vision is, what they are for? Anyone got any Google employees here? Yeah.
Sir, I think it's don't be evil.
Well, that's kind of a bumper sticker, but that's kind of a value of theirs. What they say they're for is to organize all the information in the world in an easily accessible manner. Organize all the information in the world in an easily accessible manner. Organize the world, the whole world, and then take the rest of the day off. But that's what they're for, to organize all the information in the world in an easily accessible manner. And then they do a bunch, right? They have servers, they have web pages, they have advertisers, they have, you know, office buildings, and so they do a bunch. But they do it in order to accomplish what they're for, which is to organize all the information in the world in an easily accessible manner. But this is very important when you think about that, because then, as they start doing something, they can say, well, wait a minute, is this going to get after that? So I could see, the weekly Google command and staff meeting with Google 6 sitting up there, and he's getting an update on, you know, end-of-tour awards and, you know, maintenance status and stuff like that. So he's getting out there, and he says, medical information. Where are we in medical information? Google 3.8, you're the action officer for that. What are we doing about medical information? Well, sir, here's the plan. What we're going to do is if you want to find something out about medical information, you sign on to our website, CAC card enabled, and then you go on, and we're going to ask you like 10 questions. If you have a medical malady, you put those down, and then you tab down to page 10, and if you're on prescription drugs, you put that down, and then go to Annex C. If you have a doctor's second opinion, you kind of put that down, and at the end, there's a HIPAA statement. You have to sign off on that. Blast it back to Google. What we'll do is have a little medical evaluation board here at Google. We'll take a look at what's going on. We'll put together some glossy trifolds, a couple of CDs with stuff in it like that, put it together in the manila envelope, mail it back to you. You'll get an answer in back 2 or 3 weeks. So, you know, that's how we're going to do the medical stuff, because, you know, it's really complicated and there's privacy issues. I can see Google 6 saying, well, wait a minute. Okay, you're going to do that, but that's not what we're for. What about easily accessible? That doesn't sound easily accessible to me. I mean, that sounds like, you know, AKO or something. I could see Google 6 saying, how about this, 3.8? What if we had a web page and it had one line, just one line? You type in anything you want to type in. You misspell it, it'll correct it. Type in leukemia or something. Press a return button, and within 0.4 seconds, you get a minimum of 100,000 hits. How about that? Is that easily accessible? Well, yes, sir, I guess it is. We'll see how important it is to know what you are for before you start deciding what you're going to do. Because otherwise, if you just start doing something, you may be going in the wrong direction. You know, it's very interesting that Google has gone through this because Google is one of the most highly capitalized companies in the entire world. And they don't make anything. What do? They organize stuff. They don't generate knowledge or anything. They just organize stuff that's already out there. They're like a giant closet company for information. But they organize it specifically, okay? How many of you have been to the Library of Congress within the last month? Not that many. How many of you have been on Google within the last month? Okay, now, the Library of Congress has a lot of information in it, right? Every book that's copyrighted in the United States, etc. like that. And actually, it's organized very well. It's not just like, people, here's another book, throw it in there, like a big pile of books. You go in there, they may even have a card catalog, Dewey Decimal System, all that. So it's organized. So there are organizations that organize information, but what? It's not easily accessible. You've got to go to DC, or you probably get on Thomas or something like that. But it's not, so see the brilliance of Google? They've had one of the most highly capitalized companies in the world because they know what they're for. Organize all the information in the world in an easily accessible manner. Those two things, all the information, easily accessible. If you leave out either one of the others, it's not gonna work. Now they're doing a whole bunch. But, so I always tell folks, decide what your organization is for, and then decide what you are for in your organization. Then make a to-do list after that. So I said, well, maybe I ought to, you know, walk the walk here. Let me figure out what TRAOC is for. So since this is the Army War College, I do have a little proselytizing to do about what one of the major Army commands in the Army does, and to paint that picture, and I'll relate it to the rest of the Army, and then I'll kind of get on with what we do. But to get on with what we are for. So first slide. So since this is the Army War College, you know you will not get credit for an official Army brief unless there is a line and block diagram on here. So this is gonna get you, because I don't want you to come up just one brief short before Friday and not graduate. So this is the briefing that's gonna put you over the top. This may well be your last line and block diagram at the US Army War College. So this is for clarity's sake alone. Okay, I always tell folks, never lose clarity in the search for accuracy. Sometimes we get so consumed with accurate data, we have no idea what we're talking about. So this is a clarity picture. So this is the tippy tip of the pyramid, okay, of the iceberg. So you can see already, you know, there's enough stars up here, it's like the Milky Way. So let me kind of walk you through top to bottom, because this is my proselytizing, this is my paper. Political announcement for TRAOC. At the top here, we have the doctrinally correct bloated four-star headquarters. So that goes on up here. And then we come down here to some other organizations. Over here on the left, we have ARCIC, which is not the Northern Warfare Training Center. That's Army Capability Integration Center. They are the future folks of the Army. We refer to, one of the things TRAOC is we are the architects of the Army. We design the future of the Army. That's led by Lieutenant General H.R. McMaster, great American, big thinker. He's right out of Hollywood Central Casting to be the future guy of the Army. If someone came up and said, you know what, we're going to make a movie called TRAOC, the movie. Who's going to play ARCIC? We're going to go to Hollywood Central Casting. It would be H.R. McMaster. So the Army is blessed to be very well with a lot of talent. Then we have a number of organizations, Asymmetric Warfare Group, REF, et cetera, like that. Coming over here, U.S. Army Recruiting Command. So when you walk around or you drive around the United States in the strip mall and you see Armed Forces Recruiting, say, well, that's TRAOC. That's Training and Doctrine Command. So we recruit the United States Army. We own U.S. Army Cadet Command. It generates 76% of the officer corps of the United States Army, so it generates the vast majority of the officers. U.S. Army Center for Initial Military Training, that's BOLIC, basic training, AIT, all the initial training that brings you into the military. And then under the Combined Arms Center out at Fort Leavenworth, first of all, we have all of the centers of excellence underneath them with all the commandants and with all the schools. So we came up with a unique idea that why don't we take all of the elements of Combined Arms and put them under a center? And what could we call that place? So what we have here are all of the centers of excellence, and then, of course, all the commandants, engineer school, armor school, artillery school, et cetera, like that. So this is you know, a big chunk of PMB in the Army. And of course, out at CAC, they have the Center for Army Lessons Learned, our Lessons Learned. They have CAD, Combined Arms Doctrine Directorate, so we write all the doctrine for the Army out there, et cetera, like that. So when you first step back and take a look at TRADOC, you're like, well, this has not helped at all. In fact, I mean, this looks like everything the Army has to do, but nobody wants to do. So we're just going to put it, like, in one inbox and give it a TRADOC. So it's all the stuff that doesn't seem to link to anything else. We'll just put it all together and call it TRADOC. And it's kind of a dog's breakfast there because, you know, what does the ordnance school have to do with rapid equipping force, have to do with ARCIC, have to do with recruiting, et cetera, like that? Well, if you looked at literally the to-do list, you could come to that conclusion, okay? And the to-do list is long. And so, you know, if I put up my email inbox this morning, embarrassingly, most of them are unread, you know, there'd be stuff in there about recruiting, there'd be stuff in there about designing the Army, stuff in there about, you know, Ranger School, et cetera, like that. And you'd be like, just a whole list of to-do stuff. But let me kind of walk you through what your the what are we for piece. So I said one of the monikers is TRADOC is the architect in the Army. We design the future Army. We're a concept-based, doctrine-driven Army. Not all armies are, not all services are, but we are concept-based, doctrine-driven. Well, that's what sort of ARCIC does, starts out with writing our concepts, okay? And what they do is write a concept out. We have one out here, the Army Operating Concept, affectionately known as TRADOC PM525-3-1. But it is the Army operating concept, winning a complex world. And this looks out to 2025, 2040. Hopefully you've talked about it a little bit, et cetera, like that. I won't go into great detail other than what it's going to do for us at the end. And what it does is it talks about the operating environment that we see out there in the future, a couple decades, and then determines the first order priorities and principles and capabilities that the Army needs. What are our first order capabilities? So what do we want a division to do? What do we want a brigade to do? What do we want the next attack helicopter to look like, the next tank, et cetera, like that? So we write the requirements for soldiers, for units, for materiel, for all that, and come up with a .mil PF solution, doctrine, organization, training, leader development, et cetera, like that. We create a blueprint for the Army, for the people, the materiel, et cetera, like that, to deal with the future operating environment as we've described it, you know, 2025, 2040, 2050, et cetera, like that. And it takes different shapes as we look out there. Well, and so you create this great blueprint of, you know, it's the design of the Army. But that's, it's all it is. It's sort of the blueprint. Now, if you were going to build a house, there's a couple of ways to do it. One is you could go to an architect and say, hey, look, I want a 3-bedroom, 2-bath house, colonial looking, something like that. And architect says, okay, boom, cranks out blueprint, here it is. And then you say, now I gotta go find a contractor, I gotta get a building permit, I gotta clear the land, I gotta put the foundation in, I gotta get a plumber, electrician, and stuff like that. And you go out and go to some contractors and everything. Or you could go to what's called a design build firm. Okay, a design build firm is kinda like one-stop shopping. You walk in, you say, I want a 3-bedroom, 2-bath house, they go, okay, we got it. Boom, boom, here it is. Come back in a year. We'll give you the keys to the front door. We design it. We have architects here. We have guys that will get the building permits. We have electricians, plumbers, that are like, we're design build. You walk in the front door, we'll design it, and we'll build it. You come back in a year with a check. We'll give you the keys to the front door, so like that. That's what TRADOC is for the Army. We are a design build firm, okay? So the first thing we do is design the Army, and we're in the middle of that, and I'm going to talk about that here. Then the next thing you're going to do, if you're going to build a house, what would you do? Get the general contractor, you'd get his Ford F-150, drive to Home Depot, you'd have the blueprints, have the bill of lading, any plywood, sheetrock, 2x4s, screws, nails. In other words, I need all the raw materials. You know, so I got to get the raw materials based on that. Well, that's what TRADOC does. We sort of design the future Army, and then we get the raw materials. And what are the raw materials of the Army? Us, okay? So we say, look, these are the attributes, competencies of the people in the Army, and these guys go get them. Say, recruiting command, go get me the raw materials. Cadet, go get me soldiers. Cadet command, go get me some lieutenants, okay? So recruiting command and cadet command go out and get the raw materials as required. Over here on the design, they come up, fill up the Ford F-150, drive up to the TRADOC driveway, dump them out there and say, here they are. Here's your raw materials, plywood, sheetrock, et cetera, soldiers, lieutenants, you know, I got the thing, the list, filled all the requirements, you know, some actually run sales, so we got a good price, et cetera, like that. Okay, now what are we going to do? Well, if you're going to build a house, you have the blueprints, you get the raw materials, we can start putting this thing together. dig a hole, pour the foundation, pour the, you know, get a foundation there, start framing it up, et cetera, like that. That's what we do. We got the design, we got the raw materials, let's start building this thing, put the foundation down, send them to basic training, send them to AIT, send them to Bolex, send them to airborne school, send them to ranger school, send them to welder school, whatever, et cetera, like that. Get this thing framed up based on the requirements as written by the blueprints. When we get it to a point, say, yeah, that looks good for where it is in a life cycle like that, what I'm going to do now is hand this thing off to my battle buddy, Abe Abrams. I hand this thing off to Forces Command. And what Forces Command does is make ready the Army in unit sets. Companies, battalions, brigades, divisions, et cetera. Forces Command makes ready the Army in unit sets. They take individual components, put them together, form an icon, and make it ready. And then, if the nation calls upon it, Forces Command gives the Army to combatant commanders. CENTCOM, PAYCOM, UCOM, and the combatant commanders fight the Army, okay? And they fight the Army and fight the Army, and then after a while, the combatant commander goes, you know, the Army's pretty good, but it needs to be improved. I got some captains here. They're pretty good staff officers, but they're not ready to be company commanders yet. They give it back to the Army, who gets to the TRADOC and go, I need to make them better. They're not ready for company commander yet, so we send them to Captain's Career Course. I got some great NCOs who are not ready to be Sergeant Majors yet. They give them back to us, we send them to Sergeant Majors Academy. Hey, your doctrine's all right, but you gotta, you know, this counterinsurgency coin thing, you need to update it. They give it back to us, write 324, et cetera, like that. And so what the combatant commanders do is give it back to the Army and say, I need to make it better. I need to develop the leaders more. I need you to update your doctrine. I need you to have new lessons learned, et cetera, like that. So it comes back to TRADOC, and we improve it because it started out as a three-bedroom, two-bath house. Now I want a four-bedroom, three-bath house. I want it better. Boom, TRADOC makes it better, gives it back to Forces Command, who makes it ready in unit sets, who gives it to combatant commanders to fight it. So see, that's how the Army runs. What TRADOC does is we design the Army, we acquire the Army, we build the Army and we improve the Army. Forces Command makes ready the Army. Army Material Command sustains the Army, and combatant commanders fight the Army. So that's really a whole semester of the War College right there on how the Army works. Just not that hard, okay? They're like, why did we wait till the end to bring this guy up? So this is what TRADOC does. That's what we are for, is design the Army, acquire the Army, build the Army, and improve the Army. Now you stand back and say, you know what? That sort of starts to make sense now, because we got a guy cranking out the blueprints, and the guy that cranks out the blueprints is the guy that's got to go get the raw materials. And then once he gets those, he's the guy that's got to build this thing according to the blueprints. And if it's not right, then he's got to improve it. Because if you separate it all out, which in a lot of other armies is and other services, sometimes, you know, if what was coming out of basic training wasn't good, the basic training folks would be like, well, look, you seeing what I'm getting? Have you seen what the recruiters give me? I mean, you gotta be glad that these guys can even walk and talk when they leave basic training. I mean, this is all you can do in 10 weeks. And so it's really the recruiter's fault. And then the recruiter go, well, you know, I mean, the problem is the design is all wrong. You know, I mean, the size, et cetera, like that, and the attributes and competencies, it's all wrong. But then the other folks could say, well, no, the problem is it's the schools. You know, they're just not teaching doctrine properly, et cetera, like that. We're developing good products. The school said, no, the problem is we're teaching it well. It's just we have crappy doctrine. You got to see what we have. See, the problem is now there's no one else we can point to. So the people that design this thing, write the doctrine for it, drive the schools, recruit the people, build them, train them, and constantly improve them. It's one-stop shopping. So General Milley's got one button he can push if he doesn't like what the Army is now or where it's going in the future. And so now it sort of makes sense why sort of this is all in one inbox. So that's what TRADOC is for. Now we do a bunch, but that's what we're for. So now let me talk about some specifics part of it. So let's start over here. As I said, the Army is a concept-based, doctrine-driven Army. And so we start off with a concept, and we just came up with a new concept. You can put up the first slide first. I won't go into a long discussion of it. TRADOC PM 525-3-1, although in the top, the title of it is Win in a Complex World. What we're saying is that is the problem we're trying to solve. How does the Army win in a complex world? Complex we describe and define is unknown, somewhat unknowable, constantly changing, unpredictable, et cetera, like that. Very different world than the world I grew up in at the height of the Cold War, which was focused pretty much on the Soviet Union as a armor officer, like all young armor officers. My first assignment was the Central Plains of Europe. focusing on, you know, multiple echelons that were going to come into my engagement area. So I had a well-known enemy, Soviet Union, a well-known location, Central Plains of Europe, a well-known coalition, NATO, okay? And that didn't change that much. It wasn't like Monday you're in NATO, Wednesday you're out, Friday I'm back in, et cetera. Had well-known decision-making, a little bit Byzantine, but I still got my blue NATO handbook. So it was actually a very well-known problem set. It was complicated, but it was well-known. We knew who the enemy was. We knew who the coalition was. We knew the location, et cetera, like that. We're saying in the future, we have no idea who the enemy is. We have no idea who the coalition is. We have no idea what the caveats will be, location, et cetera, like that. It's a level of complexity very different than the army that I came into. And therefore, you've got, that's how we describe the environment. It's basically an unknown world. The world I came into was a known problem set. And so when people talk to me, they'll say, hey, Perkins, you're the future guy, so, you know, what are you going to do with the Army? You know, so you got to design it, you got to acquire it. I mean, what are you doing? What are you focusing on? What are we going to do with Iran? What are we going to do with China? What are we going to do with North Korea? On and on and on and on. And I say respectfully, I said, really, that's not what I've focused on because I don't know. You don't know? I said, and really, we've sort of given up trying to figure that out. They're like, what? You just given up? What are you, stupid and lazy? I said, well, you know, I'm not going to argue that point. But the issue is, that's really not the question you have to ask if you're designing a large organization like the Army for decades out there. Because I said, I really only need to know one of two things. Do you want me to design an army to deal with a known problem, or do you want me to design an army to deal with an unknown problem? Because if you design an army to deal with a known problem, that looks a certain way. I acquire people a certain way, I train them, I develop them, I buy material, I buy certain material, and I buy it a certain way. If you want me to design an army for an unknown world, I train people differently. I develop them differently. I buy different equipment. I buy equipment differently. I write different doctrine. It's a different army. The values are the same, but what it's for is very different. Because what it's for is to deal with the unknown. Versus the other army, what it's for is to deal with the known. So you've got to ask, what are you for? And that's what we've done. And we're saying, we're kind of putting our money on, we're going to build an army that's going to focus on dealing with the unknown. Okay, and that's our bet. Now, if 15 years from now, the world is exactly as you predicted it today, you know, give me a call, I owe you a beer. We got it wrong. But we're doubling down on that the future 20 years from now is going to be very different than today, and then we can't even get close to predicting it. And therefore, we've got to sort of design the army differently. A couple of things about that. One of it is, that we think is pretty well assured, is that we have to present multiple dilemmas to the army. We've got to design an army that can present multiple dilemmas, and the army that operates is part of the joint force. As you notice in here, and please don't point that out to General Milley till I fix this slide, but we've got a little Semper Fi activity going on here, we've got US Navy down here, UNHCR, NGOs, State Department, SOFT, Space, Cyber, RAF, et cetera, like that. Actually, the only thing I don't have a picture in here is what? A soldier. So don't tell General Milley, we'll edit it quickly. But this is inherently a very joint interagency multinational picture, okay? So this is the picture that I briefed the Army operating concept all around the world on. And you can see it's got mega cities, it's got littoral areas, it's got desert, et cetera, like that. It's not the Central Plains of Europe. So what we're saying is if you want to win, and you win at the strategic level, you fight at the tactical level, but you win at the strategic level. If you want to win, you've got to present multiple dilemmas to the Army. Not a single dilemma. Multiple dilemmas to the Army. Multiple dilemmas to the enemy. Because that's how you get into sort of, first of all, your ability to deter aggression, potential aggression. And that's how you get to a position of relative advantage. Because we have found that our enemies pay attention to us probably even more than we pay attention to ourselves. And they say, you know what, the U.S. military and the U.S. as a nation in general, once they actually decide to do something, you know, how they decide to do it is a very interesting process, but once they decide to do it and they move out on it, actually they generally can accomplish it in a pretty good. So they read all our stuff, they pay attention, they go, and therefore if they're going to do this, and we describe in chapter 2 the Army operating concept, because you have to describe the environment, what we say, the enemy will avoid our strengths. They will emulate our capabilities. And I'm not going to tell you specifically Iran's going to do this, North Korea's doing that. But in general, we're saying the people we're going to go against, they will avoid our strengths and or emulate our capabilities or use our strengths against us. And that's applicable anywhere in the world. And so if our military, of which it is, become very good targeters, if they become very good targeters, which they have become, the U.S. military is our targeters par excellence. We can acquire and service targets better than anybody else in the world. We can acquire and service a target almost anywhere in the world, okay? Between national assets and UAVs and manned capabilities, etc. like that. And so we target things very well. We acquire and service targets. And if you look what goes on a lot today around the world, you know, with predators and people coming in the dead of night, etc. like that, we can target very well. So we acquire and service targets very well. And so our enemies know that. So that's a dilemma we present to them, is we can target things very well. But if they think, okay, I told you, what are the enemies going to do? It's going to avoid our strengths. So they're going to avoid being targets. Okay. So they know we can target very well. They say, you know, maybe I'll avoid being target. Maybe I'll not wear a uniform. Maybe I'll not coalesce in large groups. Maybe I'll meld into the population. Maybe I'll go subterranean. Does that sound familiar? Do you think everyone's going subterranean just because they're afraid of sunlight? You know, they're sensitive skin? No. And it's a hassle. You know, digging tunnels, that's a bitch. So the reason they're doing it is because they're avoiding our strengths. Okay, that we are driving them to do that because we are presenting them a dilemma. So they're avoiding that. Or what's the other thing? They'll use our strengths against us. So if they say, hey, I know the U.S. are great targeters. And if that's the only dilemma I can present them, they can say, well, I can avoid it, or I can use the strength against them. So if, you know, if I'm ISIS in northern Iraq, and say, you know what, if I start cutting people's heads off and start doing all kinds of atrocious things, I bet it's a matter of time till the U.S. does what? Targets me, okay? So I can try to avoid it with my senior leaders like that, or get some suicide drivers and bombers, get some white Hilux Toyota pickup trucks, apparently the vehicle of choice out there in the world. I'll put some suicide bombers in it. So, you know, suicide bomber, volunteer, don't have a lot invested in them in PME and medical care, so like that. So suicide bomber, put them in a white Hilux pickup truck, or better yet, put them in a Ford F-150 or Humvee that the U.S. gave the Iraqis or something. So put them in a stolen vehicle, okay? Put them in a stolen vehicle, and I'll start driving around Mosul or something. And guess what? They probably figure, just a matter of time till the U.S. does what? Target them, okay? And so, you know, we're watching the nightly news or in your local KOC or talk or something like that, you're watching Kill TV, terrorists driving around a pickup truck around Mosul or a Ford F-150 or a Humvee or something like that. All of a sudden, little X shows up, tracking them. We know what happens next, okay? X going along, kaboom. We targeted them. And so high fives, all in the talk. Yeah, we got them. We won that exchange of firepower, okay? You know, that Hilux didn't stand a chance against, you know, the smart weapon system coming down at it. You know, didn't stand a chance against it. So we won that exchange of firepower almost every time. We have yet to have a pickup take down a drone or an F-15. So we always win that exchange of firepower. But let's take a look at the economic exchange ratio. So say we had a couple F-15s up there, they got fuelers, refueling, et cetera, like that. You know, each one of those smart weapons, probably $1 million a pop or something. I mean, look at how much money we had to put in to target that Hilux pickup truck. And the pickup truck, like I said, probably stolen truck, volunteer suicide bomber, something like that, not a lot there. So the economic exchange ratio, probably not to our advantage, okay? In fact, if you're the terrorist, say, you know what, maybe I'll just keep doing this. Maybe I'll just keep kind of expending this capability of the U.S. if they only present me with one dilemma, if that's all they do. That's why we're saying, so we will win that fight. We will win that tactical exchange of firepower, but we may not win the strategic exchange of all elements of national power. Because when you fight, you focus on synchronizing and delivering firepower, okay? When you fight, you focus on synchronizing and delivering firepower. And we're all about that. And we talk about a lot of it in there. But when you want to win, as compared to just fight, when you want to win, you focus and deliver elements of national power. You focus, synchronize, and deliver elements of national power, of which fighting is one. It's a subcomponent. But if all you do is figure out how you deliver firepower, you may win the fight, but you may not win the total exchange of sort of strategic ratios out there, which is why we have changed our document. I grew up with 100-5 Operations Airland Battle. Okay, that's when I grew up, the Army Bible, we've seen it. If you do you have that in the backup, Dana or Tim or whoever's there? We'll see how adept you are with the picture from 100-5. So it's the one I grew up in, Central the Plains of Europe, external like that. And it defined the problem that we're gonna design the Army to go deal with as well. And that problem was fight outnumbered in when, right on 100-5. Fight outnumbered in when, okay, that's a problem. Notice what we told you to focus on here? Fight. What are we telling you to focus on here? When. Okay, related yet different concepts, okay? Because fighting has to do with synchronizing and delivering firepower. If you read 100-5, great manual as it was all about synchronizing and delivering firepower. If you read our manual, it's about synchronizing and delivering elements of national power, okay? Because we want to figure out how we win. Now, I told folks we went through the same process as they did 100-5 because it was historic in many ways. It brought us out of Vietnam and gave us a new focus, combined arms maneuver, et cetera, like that. So I said we did exactly the same thing. We wrote this concept, did exactly the same thing, came up with exactly the same product, only it's completely different. Now, the first difference I have to point out to the armor officers and the crew is this is color and this is black and white. Now, that is more than just a slick marketing ploy, but it is a slick marketing ploy. One of the ones is the environment you're operating in. Known problem, as I said, if you stood in the folded gap and looked east, it would look eerily similar to this. Known problem, unknown problem. Tactical operational focus, strategic focus, including tactical and operational, okay? And then the level of complexity, complicated world, complex world, okay? So now what does that mean? Now that you've outlined it, go back to the big one, the winning a complex world. Hence, the present multiple dilemmas to the enemy. And I'll get more to it, maneuver from multiple domains. I'll talk about that here in a minute. Back to this present multiple dilemmas to the enemy. And this is, we have to think differently in the Army about that, because that's actually not, we may think we think that way, but I'm telling you, it's not. Because when you take a look at the kind of systems we buy, the organizations we form, et cetera, like that, and I compare it to the analogy, the difference between playing checkers or chess, okay? If you play checkers, you lay out the board and you put all the checker pieces out there. And each piece on the board is the same as every other piece. Red one doesn't have any more capability than the black one, and each red one has the same capability as every other red one. Each black one has the same capability as the black one. And checkers is a tactical game. Why? Because you must acquire in service the enemy's other checkers, okay? So it's a very tactical game. Everything has the same capability, and what you must do is acquire in service every other checker. You don't win until you clear the board, until you take all their checkers off. So you go out there, boom, boom, like that. This has the same capability, so like that. Tactical game. Chess is a strategic game for a couple of reasons. One, every piece of the chessboard has different capabilities, has strengths and weaknesses, okay? The knight can do certain things, a rook can do certain things, a king can do certain things. They all have different capabilities and are all the same, but they complement each other, okay? And to win at chess, you actually don't have to take that many pieces off the board, theoretically. You don't have to clear the board. You just have to present a dilemma to the enemy with regards to the point that they may have a move left. It's just that wherever they move, you've got something for them, okay? So if they move here, there your knight's gonna get them. If they move here, your rook's gonna get them. If you move here, something else is gonna get them. You've got something different, multiple dilemmas for them, okay? And you've left them maneuver space. It's just that wherever they move, you've got a dilemma for them. And they can say, well, I could do something to deal with the knight, but then I can't deal with the rook, et cetera, like that. And again, you can win at chess and have the majority of the pieces still on the board. You have just got yourself to a position of relative advantage. You are presenting multiple dilemmas to the enemy such that you now can consolidate your gains. They've got nowhere to go, okay? So what we're doing is we're designing the army and we're developing our leaders to be chess players, not just checker players. Here is the big challenge. When you show up to the game and just the board is there, it's the same board. The checkers board and the chess board are the same board. So what if you show up playing checkers and your opponent shows up playing chess? So that's why you've got to come to grips with what are you for before you decide what to do. Because what if you came, what you came for to play chess, but you play by checkers rules, it's not going to work, okay? So you get to decide what you're for. So that's why we decided the Army is for, is we're going to operate the tactical, operational, strategic level in an unknown problem set, okay? So how do we go about doing that? So these are, I could go on and on about these, but these are some of the first order capabilities, which means we're not looking for homogeneity in the Army. I need multiple dilemmas. Not homogeneity of capability, not homogeneity of units, on and on and on like that. I need multiple dilemmas from multiple domains. Next slide. So the term we're coining here, Chief hasn't completely approved it, but we're getting there. Multiple domain battle. So I grew up with air-land battle, and then we had a version air-sea battle. Okay, so air-land battle is what? Two domains. Air-sea battle, two domains. Well, we're saying multi-domain battle. All of the domains out there, okay, cyber, space, maritime, et cetera, like that, for the Army, for all the services, joint combined arms maneuver, joint and combined arms maneuver. And what we say is, as we look out to the world, that you could see that picture that I grew up with, 100-5, air-land battle, very linear. Very linear. I mean, that was right out of the manual. Very linear. It was a very linear battlefield, first echelon, second echelon, you know, deep, close, rear, et cetera. Very linear. And it was about acquiring servicing targets, fight outnumbered and win. What we're saying here is we've got to get to a position of relative advantage and be able to consolidate our gains so that it puts us at a strategic position of advantage. Those gains could be political, they could be economic, they could be military, and generally it's a combination of all of them. You cannot consolidate your military gains without consolidating your political gains. You can't consolidate political gains unless you have the military capability to do it. Economic has a long-term effect to it, so like that. You've got to think much more holistically about that if you want to win other than just fight. Now, you must be able to fight. Don't walk away here saying, well, Perkins says we're not going to fight anymore. No, you must be able to fight, but that becomes a given. You then have to go to the next step and figure out how you're going to win. So what we have to, so if we take a look at what our enemies are doing, as I said, they've figured out we are very good targeters. So what do? They avoid us, emulate our capabilities, or use our strengths against us. The other thing they figure that the U.S. is very good at, they've learned this from Desert Storm and then in some ways OIF-1, et cetera, like that. They said if the U.S. gets a foothold in, if they get in your area of operation and they have some level of security, they're just going to build the proverbial pile of iron, and it just doesn't end well, at least tactically, over and over again. If the U.S. gets in, it's a problem, because they have great logisticians. I said Army Material Command sustains the Army, actually sustains the Joint Force in many ways. And once it starts, you can't turn it off, even if we want to ourselves, okay? And so they've learned. And so, hence, a lot of them are focused on one, anti-access error denial, A2AD, keep the U.S. out. We've learned that lesson. Keep them out, don't let them get in, avoid being a target, on and on and on, okay? And so we see all these problems of A2AD around the world. So we got to figure out, well, so how do you get after that? Well, there is sort of a misunderstanding of that, because we look at A2AD domain-specific, because everyone hasn't read our book yet, okay? Multiple dilemmas in multiple domains, multi-domain battle. And so you've seen, you know, exercises where they'll take, you know, like a Kaliningrad example, and they put this A2AD umbrella over it. I go to exercise all the time. I'm going to be at one with some senior leaders in OSD on Friday. And we put this, like, cone of non-penetration over, like, half a continent. I'm like, have you ever fought a war? Do you know how hard that is just to have this non-penetrable cone through all domains out there? I said, I've spent multi-rotations in the central core of the National Training Center, and it's much smaller than the continent of Europe. And we've had multiple armor brigades, and there's holes that you can drive regiments of tanks through. You know, you just can't, you know, present a problem that it is total anti-access, anti-denial for every domain. What you can do is you can have certain domains that are very difficult. The domains that are very difficult to operate in when somebody's trying to provide anti-access, anti-denial, are those domains that have a level of homogeneity to them. Maritime domain, air domain, because you don't have IV lines. It is a little bit easier, especially with technology, to provide a level of A2 AD to it. The domain that is very difficult to keep somebody out if they want to get in is the land domain. I'm not just saying this as a parochial land guy. I said, when we wrote this manual, my job wasn't to be overly parochial, it was just to be adequately parochial as a land guy. It is a domain that presents the greatest difficulty in preventing penetration into it. So what we're saying is, if you take a look at anti-access, anti-denial type things, is what we're going to have to be able to do. Not only can you not control an entire continent at once, but you probably can't subjugate it at once either. I always say war is a series of temporary conditions. So war, especially this unknown war, is going to be a series of temporal effects going on. So what we're saying is that we want to have temporary domain superiority by this cross-domain capability, that we pick areas of which we want to focus all our activities in all our domains to have a level of temporal superiority of our time and choosing, so that we can break through an anti-access, anti-domain kind of environment. So we can get to a position of relative advantage and then start to consolidate our gains. And then we can move this, you know, it wouldn't be a nice geometric shape like that, but you can move these areas of combined domain superiority in a temporal manner around the battlefield, if nothing else, to show that you can do it. Because now what you're doing is you're starting to deter possible adventurism, because you're saying, you know what, you almost can't keep us out. The cost of doing that is, we have more dilemmas than you have solutions to. So about a month ago, Deputy Secretary Wark was down at TRADOC, and we had Hawk Karloff from Air Combatant Command, Phil Davison from Fleet Forces Command. They're kind of like the force comms of the Navy and Air Force, and call sign Whaler from MCDIC from the Marine Corps. And we were there with TRADOC, and we talked about various things like this, about how can we use all of the joint force, as well as political, economic, and so like that, to get these temporal aspects of where we can gain domain superiority that then we can exploit and continue to consolidate gains. And if you take a look at historical examples of that, this is actually not something new. We just really haven't thought about it that way. So if you look at the Israeli experience in the 73 war, initially the Israelis lost about 25% of the Israeli Air Force to Egyptian air defense systems as they were going after them with the Air Force, trying to take them out with a version of a hard missile, et cetera, like that. It wasn't until they took maneuver forces and the Israelis maneuvered on the Egyptian air defense systems by the ground. So they maneuvered on them, took out the air defense systems by the ground, which then opened up the domain of the air, which then allowed the Israeli Air Force to penetrate. So the Israeli Air Force gained dominance in the air initially by using forces from the ground. So this multi-domain aspect is not necessarily new. In fact, I was talking to folks, and I said, the good news is we actually already have a doctrinal term for that coming from the heavy maneuver side of the Army. I said, actually, we already have a term for using heavy maneuver forces against ground-based air defense system. They said, really? What's that term? I said, yeah, it's a doctrinal term. We call it easy shooting. And so we're thinking very differently about how we operate with the Air Force, Navy, Marine Corps, and Army about this multi-domain stuff. I was out at PACOM last month with Admiral Harry Harris, a PACOM commander, said, you know what? What if you had, from the land domain, you could put an enemy's Navy at risk, or at least portions of it, okay? What if we had an anti-ship HIMARS missile? Right now, we have artillery systems that go from dirt to dirt. The physics is about the same if dirt to water. You know, the relative humidity of where the weapon lands is of little significance, quite honestly. to most of the physics involved. And so it said, so what if you could put part of a Navy at risk from a land? What if you had an anti-ship HIMARS capability, okay? What if you could put it in a container that looked like a shipping container? And you could put these containers all over various parts of the Pacific. You could even put it on a civilian container ship, okay? That's a dilemma, because now they don't know what to look for. Hide things in plain sight, okay? And then use a high demand, low density asset like a submarine that once you find it, you know what it is. It's not like, well, I think that's a cargo submarine. And then use that for other things that are very unique to that and not using it for things that maybe something else could take it. And so, see, that becomes a dilemma to the enemy. You have to think very differently. So we, everyone says, well, you know, the problem is all our operation centers, they emit all this electronic stuff now because of the network and all this stuff, the trade-off designs, it's a disaster, on and on and on. And so they're just going to target us because you can RF them like that. So we've got to, you know, turn all our radios off and, you know, have like electronic camo nets or something like that. I said, well, that's a way to look at it. Or, because what you're trying to do is you're trying to present yourself as a needle in a haystack. Okay, he's like, here's the needle, it's a talk, and I'm trying to hide it. But again, once you find the needle, you know what it is. What if you made the talk a needle in a pile of needles that look like every other needle? What if instead of trying to reduce your electromagnetic spectrum, you increase it? And you make everything out there look like a brigade talk. You know, every vehicle you make it emit like a brigade talk. So the enemy looks out there, all they see is like 10,000 brigade talks. Now it's a needle in a pile of needles. That's a dilemma, okay? If you take a look at what takes more time, discriminating amongst like targets takes much more time than fighting a dissimilar target within an area of other similar things. A needle in a haystack is much easier to find than a needle in a pile of needles, okay? But see, you've got to think properly about what the future is and think differently. That's why you have to determine, do you want an army to deal with a known problem or an unknown problem? Because once you go on this unknown road, you actually start doing a lot of things differently. You do a lot of things differently. You can't decide who the enemy is, so you can't suboptimize the army to go against this weapon system. You have to think about an enemy capability, your capability, and then how can you innovate that capability, okay? Because that's one of the other things that once you decide what kind of army you want to build, what's it for? What's an army for? Armies are not cheap, okay? We're very, very expensive. We are hundreds of billions of dollars a year. The State Department only had a tenth of our budget, right, sir? They'd be swimming in, you know, high water there. So we're very expensive, so we need to be for something. Okay. So what we're saying is we've got to change ourselves to deal with this unknown world out there. And if you come to the grips that the world is unknown, I said you train people differently, you develop them differently, you build different kinds of capability, and you buy different kind of equipment and you buy it differently, and you words have different definitions. Okay, so I'm the doctrine czar of the army, so you know. Good thing is I get to define what the words mean, so I can never be doctrinally incorrect, because I'll just say, oh, I just changed the meaning of that word. Doesn't quite work that way, but, you know, we actually think about these things a lot. I know you'll rest easier at night knowing somebody does. So one of the things that when we think about this, we say innovate. We've got to innovate. You hear it all the time, right? When I was out at Google, I was out at San Jose and Silicon Valley and innovate. But there's really two major ways you innovate, okay? Two major ways. And everybody wants to innovate, right? Who says, you know, I'm kind of the legacy guy. I just want to keep things like they are, maybe turn it back 5 years or so. That's number one bullet in my support form. Call me no change. Everybody wants to innovate. But see, you got to decide, innovate for what? In a known world, you innovate to deliver level of differentiation. You innovate to deliver level of differentiation. Why? Because you know what you're innovating against. So I grew up in a known world, okay? So I knew every T-72 was bad. There was no doubt. I actually had the flashcards to prove it, okay? Bad, you know, picture of an M-60, good. T-55, bad, you know, on and on. M-113, good. The problem now is, when I was growing up, all T-72s were bad. Now we have T-72s in NATO, okay? So there's no sense differentiating against that. And as a matter of fact, We've sold M1s to people that, you know, when the balloon goes up, I'm not sure what side of the LD they're going to be on. So now do I innovate against my own vehicle? See, that's why differentiation, and what else? You differentiate if you have a known enemy, a known problem set, because you have it. We would bring T-72s to Fort Knox. We would shoot at it. We would get its ballistics, its armor capabilities, stuff like that, and we would differentiate against that because we knew that's what we're going for. Now, when you differentiate, when you innovate to deliver differentiation, it involves a couple of characteristics of the organization. One, it takes a long time, right? Because it generally requires a lot of research and development. You kind of get exquisite solutions to specific problems, but you're willing to do that because you know what the problem is. It's a T-72, okay? And that's what the Soviets have. It's not like the Soviets are going to buy Leopards. They're going to have this. So I'm willing to invest the time, I'm willing to invest the money, and I'm willing to invest the capability of an exquisite solution to deal with that, because that's all I have to deal with. So you end up having a process that has a lot of R&D, very long lead time, very expensive, exquisite weapon systems, but they deal specifically with one problem set, the known problem set, okay? The problem is, in an unknown world, I don't know what to differentiate against. Is it T-72s? Is it M1? Is it Hilux pickup trucks? Is it explosively formed penetrators? What? I don't know what to differentiate about. So in an unknown world, you don't focus on delivering differentiation. You focus on increasing the rate of innovation. You focus on increasing the rate of innovation. Because you don't know what to differentiate against. All you do know is that things are going to change quickly. And I've got to be able to innovate quickly. I need to get things into my system quickly. I need to have soldiers and leaders that learn quickly. I need to have low threshold level of bringing a new system in so I can bring it in very quickly, because I have to increase the rate of innovation, not deliver differentiation. And which means each turn of innovation may be less of a turn than the differential turn was, but I can do it more quickly, okay? The problem is, when were all of our acquisition processes and POM systems and all that, when were they put in place? During the Cold War. What were they designed to do? Deliver differentiation. So when everyone goes, the acquisition process is all screwed up, this is all screwed up. No, it's not. It's working exactly like it's designed, because that's what it was for. That our system that we have right now was designed to deliver differentiation. The problem is, what it was for no longer pertains to what the world is going to be. We need to deliver a system that doesn't focus on differentiation, but focuses on a high rate of innovation. And that's not what it's designed to do. So everyone says the acquisition system is broken. I said, no, it's working too well. It is working too, it delivers such a level of differentiation that it takes forever and it's very expensive. And that's just not useful in today's world. But see, you've got to go through this process. Well, why do you want a high rate of innovation versus level? You can describe the environment. And because that's why, is a good mentor of mine, former chief of staff of the Army, General Sullivan, always reminds me, the intellectual leads the physical. Intellectual leads the physical. So we have a whole annex in here on innovation. Because a high rate of innovation is very important in a complex world. Level of differentiation may be very important in a complicated world, but a high rate of innovation is very important in a complex world. Go to the innovation slide. I think it's like two slides now. Stop. So we just had one. We've had a couple of innovation seminars that we hosted with William and Mary. I've been, again, all around all these high-tech companies, everything like that. The problem is, innovation is kind of like the word synchronization. It's being overused. What does innovation mean? Well, this, Excel like that. So again, in the Army, we love to define things. We love to have a doctrinal answer. So, you know, I'm here as your doctrinal guru. This is the Army's doctrinal answer. Is the innovation is the conversion of new ideas into valued outcomes, okay? Again, it's like organize all the information in the world in an easily accessible manner. It's a combination of both. It's the conversion of new ideas into valued outcomes. It's not random ideas on a PowerPoint slide, okay? So all the time, people think, well, he's an innovative thinker. Look at that PowerPoint. It's got flying carpets. It's got invisible tanks. It's got all that stuff. Okay, that's an innovative idea, but that's not innovation. Innovation is taking an idea and making it a reality. Honestly, we've got more ideas about what we want to do than we could ever get to. The problem we have in the Army and the joint force in general is taking an idea and turning it, it's not innovative ideas, it's the act of innovation, creating valued outcomes from it. Why? Because our system is designed to deliver differentiation. I mean, you look at all the statutes and regulations and all that, and we don't think about it properly. And so what we are trying to do is we are changing a lot on how we can do this just within sort of the microcosm of the Army. In fact, on Thursday, I'll be in the Pentagon all day with the Chief and the Vice and others talking about how we're going to increase the rate of innovation amongst others. It's called the Future Force Update that TRADOC does, the Chief, every month. But you notice it's not just buy new stuff. It's not just buy new stuff, okay? Because that's not innovation either. In fact, it may be taking what we have and using it differently. Because what we want to do is develop leaders, critical thinkers, et cetera, like that. That's why if you're dealing with an unknown world, you develop people differently. You train them differently. You organize your systems differently, et cetera, like that. You run your schools differently. You run your institutions differently. You run different. You have different doctrine, et cetera. So I was recently out at the Army Warfighting Assessment. It's an exercise that TRADOC runs, and we're trying to look to the future. We work new concepts out there. It's partnered with NIE. We bring out new technology, et cetera, like that. And one of the problems we're facing around the world are UAVs, okay? But I told you so, right? Chapter 2, the Army Operating Concept. What did I say the enemy's gonna do? Avoid our strengths or emulate our capabilities. We have UAVs. They say it works pretty good with the Americans. We'll have UAVs. See, that's the difference in this world. In the world I was growing up in, it was differentiation. So I had night vision stuff. Soviets didn't have night vision stuff. Okay, I had laser rangefinders. They didn't have it. That was in a known world. In the unknown world, you pretty much have to plan on everything you have. The enemy probably has a version of it. You have night vision devices. They probably have night vision. In fact, almost every technology that we have, somebody else in the world, if you want to buy it and or steal it, can get your hands on it. Because of all the capabilities we have, the most easily transferable capability is technology. It's the most easily transferable. When I was growing up, you'd have to have reams of blueprints or microfiche or something like that. Now you can steal the plans for a joint strike fighter on a thumb drive, you know. So our technology is our most transferable capability. So when I was growing up, technology provided us a what? A level of differentiation. The problem is we cannot rely on technology to provide a level of differentiation because it is the most transferable. So what we have to do is take our technology and innovate faster, not rely on the differentiation. So UAVs is one of the problems because, again, I told you this in Chapter 2. We actually have a whole thing on robotic and autonomous systems, but if you have something, it's just a matter of time till the enemy's going to have it. They're going to emulate your capability. So we've seen them all around the world. You've seen them. They're proliferated everywhere, and it's a real problem. And in fact, so we're trying to figure out how do we deal with it? You know, how do we deal with UAV swarms, et cetera, like that? So we had one of our very close allies was in engagement with an enemy, and they had some micro UAVs, kind of like the quadcopters you can buy at Walmart for like $500. And they shot it down with a Patriot missile. And they hit it. It worked, okay? They won that firepower exchange. High fives at the talk. We got it, okay? So how much does a Patriot missile cost? It's more than $1 million for $500 UAVs. That's not what I would call a positive exchange ratio. You're not getting to a position of relative advantage. You're spending $1 million for every time they do it. So when I talked to all our folks, I said, look, part of our requirements is I can no longer generate $1 million solutions to $100 problems, okay? I need a $50 solution to a $100 problem. But see, when you're focusing on differentiation, cost is not an issue. But see, if you're looking at rate of innovation, that is part of the requirement now. I need to present a dilemma to the enemy cheaper than he can present me a problem. That's not how we've thought previously like that. And I need to be able to improve my dilemma to the enemy faster than he can mitigate it because it's just a matter of time until he mitigates it. So whenever I come up with a solution, I have to have in my mind, this is only going to work for a while. So am I already thinking about the next one and the next one? Are my operators thinking about it? So long story to set up, was out at Fort Bliss. So we got UAV, so we got all these quadcopters. And so we said, okay, we're gonna figure out how we do it. We know the physics is on our side that a Patriot missile will take them down, okay? So if you wanna spend a couple $1 million for a $100 copter, go right ahead. We said, you know, what's another way to go about this? Well, what if we brought it down with electrons, okay? Once you generate electrons, they're relatively free. I mean, you gotta generate them and aim them and everything, but they're cheaper than a Patriot, okay? So what we did, we took a whole bunch of stuff that the Army already had. So I go out there, and we had our cyber there. I had guys from the fire center that had been over in the Ukraine and seen what the, you know, the Lone Green Band and surrogate forces had done, you know, with UAVs and various stuff like that. And the fire center folks, the aviation center folks there, and First Armored Divisions there, we used them. And so I come out to this field site, and there's this platypus-looking vehicle. It's a version of an MRAP, and then we bolted on a type of radar on it, and then we had thermal sights bolted on it that had a big cable going over here, and we had this big thing that would generate electrons, and our cyber was out there, and you can do all this and fire electrons. So they're like, hey, sir, come on up here, and, you know, this young sergeant's going to tell you all about this. So next slide is to highlight this. So drivers of innovation. So I said, it's not just about buying stuff. It's about using what you use better. Now, we've worked a lot with John Hockman's Jet Propulsion Lab and others, and a lot of folks look at this in industry because they live or die by it. And they have a 20-year study looking at companies that are very innovative. And it's interesting when you look at the data because it's sometimes a little bit counterintuitive. So a lot of times people say, you know, this organization is not working right. I got to make it better, stuff like that. What's the first thing we do? Let's reorganize ourselves, redo a line of block diagram. You work for you, and you know we're going to reorganize, move things around, stuff like that. What's another thing we may do? Hey, let's give incentives. You know, good idea box, ice comments, 10,000 bucks, stuff like that. You can change who's going to say yay or nay, decisionize like that, and then you can take a look at how we move information around. What's very interesting is those are in the order of a 20-year study of multi-organizations, those are in the order of effectiveness, okay? The least effective way to get innovation is to restructure yourself, which is usually the first thing we do in the Army when we want to get something better. Let's change the MTO. Let's, you know, we'll restructure ourselves. Scientifically proven the worst way to get innovation. Very time-consuming, very expensive, a lot of volatility, stuff like that, okay? Or we'll say, hey, look, you know, give you an incentive, promote you, stuff like that. The second worst way to get innovation is through motivators, pay, promotion, stuff like that. Actually, proven not to. The number one way to increase rate of innovation is increase information flow. This generates 6 times the rate of innovation as this, okay? And the second most effective way is align decision rights. That doesn't mean push every decision to the lowest level. That means make the right decision at the right level. You don't want privates making 4-star decisions, and you don't want 4-stars making private decisions. Either one has a downside to it. Okay, so you've got to figure out what they are. So back to my experience out at Fort Bliss. So I walk out there, this Sergeant E5, and he says, okay, sir, here's what we're going to do is we're going to bring up all these quadcopters. You're going to see all these screens and this platypus looking thing. You're going to see them, and then we're going to target them and ID them and bring them down and everything. So I said, okay. You have my attention. So they start bringing up all these quadcopters, swarms that are coming at them. He goes, sir, see this one there. I look in, you know, I can't see crap, but I'm like, okay, whatever. He goes, it's the one there. And then, boom, he starts zapping them, and they start falling out of the sky. And he says, now, sir, what we do when I, and he said, now, when I first got here, this wasn't set up right, so I go with the contractor, we open up the console, I redesign this, we put this over there like that. He says, now, I also have to deconflict it with airspace because I don't want to do that to Apaches. You know, I don't want them falling out of the sky. So, very insightful young sergeant. So he says, you know, I have to deconflict by airspace, and we have airspace coordination measures, and we do this, and then all of that, and I get the operations where I look at that, and, you know, he said, and at first it wasn't working right, but then we changed this, and we rewired this out there and everything like that. I said, wow, this is very impressive, and he got all of them. I said, so how long have you been an air defender? How long have you been working this stuff? He goes, sir, I'm not an air defender. He says, I'm an artilleryman. I said, an artilleryman? I mean, he's talking airspace coordination measures, this, and deconflicted by altitude, and target acquisition, everything like that. I said, this is incredible, and you've, like, rewired this whole system and like that. He goes, sir, I've been at this a long time. I said, oh, so how long have you been working? He said, I have been out here all week. See, that's a high rate of innovation. It's a high rate of innovation. Take an artillery sergeant, E5, sergeant. See, this is the problem. Here's all this stuff. Here's this thing here, generating electron. Here's how it works and stuff like that. So what we're going to do is, and here's the contractor, sergeant. You sit down with this contractor, and you have a free flow of information. Because scientifically speaking, the more you can compress the information from those who design a solution to those who use a solution, the more you can align those, the higher rate of innovation. So we say, Sergeant, you get with these guys, and you work, and guess what? Decision rights, you can do whatever you want here. You can rip open this console, you can rewire this, you can do anything you want. Your decision. You give the contract, you get the right information flow, et cetera, like that. Now, the right to serve, we didn't say, and you can redesign the entire air defense structure of the United States Army. No, we didn't give him that decision right. We said, but this problem set, you do whatever you want. You get with the contractor and everything, you can do whatever you want, exchange whatever information, you solve this problem, okay? And he did. Like I said, he spent the whole week. By the time I got there, boom, they're falling down out of the sky, you know, like rain, okay? We didn't redesign the air defense structure, and we didn't promote the kid. Okay, now I'm hoping he does well in the Army, et cetera, like that, okay? But it kind of validated that. But see, that's why you have to you've got to start thinking through this stuff. What kind of Army do you want? High rate of innovation. That's how you solve problems now. You take the people that are coming up with the solution, people use it, you put them together. That's why we stood up AWA last year. We put it together. I got to get stuff in the hands of soldiers so they can innovate it faster. I've got to change my contracts with contractors so I can allow that to occur. I've got to be able to open up stuff. I need open architecture, okay? Which some of my contractor friends don't like. In other words, I need everyone to have access to the software. I need everyone to have access to the electronics. It's not proprietary, because I want to innovate it. Because I know the software you're giving me, contractor, it's only going to last for a while. And then the enemy's going to figure out how to jam it or do something else, or I may want to plug something else into it. I may want to plug something else into it. So you, when I, the United States Army, buy something, I'm going to have intellectual rights to that software because I want to innovate quickly. Okay, so you start changing dramatically the equipment you buy and how you buy it and how you train leaders. What I'd like to do now to leave time for Q&A, what do I have till 11:30? Is it 11:30? Okay, open up for questions. So this, you know, tip of the iceberg, try to explain what the Army is for and then, or what TRADOC is for, and then the kind of things we're looking at and how we're designing. It's actually a pretty radical redesign. If you're involved with any of the institutional part of the Army, with how we develop requirements, with how we do contracting, with how we do any of that stuff, it's a pretty dramatic change in how we do it. It's not gonna happen overnight, but it is happening quicker than folks may think. And who do you think the biggest advocates of it are? Lieutenants, captains, sergeants, they got this. That sergeant's like, I got it. Give me a week, General, I got it. Okay, questions? Be about anything. Doesn't have to be about this. Answers? Sir.
Sir, Mark Gregors, 7R17. You talk about innovation. You talk about the younger guys getting it. When I leave this place, I'm going back to the five-sided building.
Yeah.
Where I try not
to see you there multiple times a week.
Yes, sir. Try to think outside the box as they stuff you in a cubicle.
Windowless cubicle.
Roger, sir. I'm on the fifth row from a window outside. The innovation is happening out there, and it's happening at TRADOC. I deal with capability documents coming into the building.
Okay.
I work
in
the G8.
Yeah. I spent a lot of time with Joe Murray.
Still waiting for a whole bunch of capability documents for capabilities we're supposed to get from TRADOC, and some of them are like 10 or 12 years old. Yeah. Where are you going to interject the innovation to get that stuff to the building?
Yeah, so this is where we are in this transition period. So none of the rules exterior to the Army really have changed. I mean, part of the problem is the things that we're doing now, we're generating round pegs, but all the holes are still square, so we're trying to figure out how to do it. So we still sort of have to like translate one to the other. So specifically, the way we're getting after this, and this takes a while to turn around, is there's a couple of things we have focused on. In fact, do we have the Big 6 plus 1 up there? So here we go. So when I grew up, air, land, battle, Big 5, okay? And that worked very well because it focused senior leadership, et cetera, like that. What we've done, this is sort of pre-decisional, but General Milley has said he's almost there. We have the Big 6 plus 1. The big one is soldier and team performance and overall match. But these are the six, kind of like the Big 5. But the Big 5 were things, you know, M1, Bradley, Apache, et cetera, like that. These are capabilities, advanced protection, for instance, okay? And this gets, the problem is this is not how the system, this is not, you don't, they don't, the system doesn't take capability documents like this. So we're having to take what we have and we're modifying it. So here's a great example. So I'm giving you, you know, these heavy mechanized things, so it sounds like I'm a little parochial, but anyways, that's the environment I came from. So a tank. So you have a tank out there. And we say it's a combination of mobility, protection, and firepower, mobile, protective, firepower. We say, look, we're going to go to a high rate of innovation, a world that changes very quickly. So now when I'm looking at, and I'll give you weapon systems, because that's generally what the capability documents are for, what part of that tank, mobility, protection, and firepower, becomes obsolete the quickest? Or what is it that the enemy provides quickly a dilemma to us? The problem we have, okay, since 9/11, since the Twin Towers came down, if you take a look at our ground vac vehicles, Strikers, tanks, Bradley, stuff like that, have we increased the mobility of them? Bigger engines or anything like that? I mean, not really. Have we increased the firepower? Does it have a 150 millimeter? Have we, no. What have we increased on them? Protection, right? Why? Because the enemy's ability to present us a dilemma with their lethality to us protection is the thing that advances the quickest with the cheapest amount of money. And our ability to respond for it, to it takes the longest and is most expensive. So I have a tank. The problem is the protection is hardwired into that tank, right? It's the armor on it. So if I want to increase the protection, you know, I send it back to Lima, Ohio, and recast a hull or bolt more stuff on or something like that. In other words, it's hardwired. The tank shows up, its protection is hardwired. The problem is the enemy's ability to thwart that protection. Here's an electronically formed penetrator. Make it in somebody's garage, okay? Put it, you know, artillery shell under the road, et cetera, like that. We all lived in Iraq, Afghanistan. Here's an ATGM-6. Okay, Perkins, there's an ATGM-7. I don't have to retrain you or anything like that. It works the same way, et cetera, like that. You know, multiple warhead, et cetera, like that. Much easier for the enemy to thwart our protection than for us to improve it. Therefore, what I've said is, therefore, when you take a look at our formations, mobility, protection, and firepower, I have to figure a way to increase the rate of improving the protection faster than the enemy can increase the rate of providing lethality. So that's why this is one of the top ones here, advanced protection. So what I'm saying is the physics of using armor to provide my protection, I am now on a diminishing returns. The cost and time and the physics of it is working against me. It's getting heavier and heavier. So I have to look at active protection. So we're looking at new ways to protect our vehicles rather than the way that I grew up with. So I was in Israel about a month ago, because TRADOC is a mil-to-mil executive agent with Israeli, and they put me in a Merkava tank, which has the trophy system, which is an active protection system that it detects incoming rounds, and then it destroys them before they get to the tank. And they put me in a Merkava and shot at me live fire. Knock on wood. It worked. It's a hell of a sales pitch. But I use that example because that's a new way of looking at protection. And then, therefore, when the enemy comes up with a new RPG or new something like that, you tweak the software or you put a different, you know, mitigator in there or something like that. In other words, I don't have to recast a hull. So what we're saying is I've got to change the requirements process. Because before, what we did was take, and in fact, what if the lethality is not even organic to the vehicle? What if the lethality that I'm looking for is a robotic and autonomous system strategy? So we put together a series of strategies to deliver capabilities, combat vehicle modernization strategy, not a plan to buy vehicles, a strategy to build capability, a robotic and autonomous system strategy, not to buy robots, but to build a capability. So maybe eventually the next combat vehicle's lethality is not organic, but is autonomous to the vehicle. Maybe its protection is not hardwired, but is something that I can change quite quickly. Our requirements process doesn't take that kind of input, because what it takes is I'm gonna put a tank, I'm gonna put it in the middle of the desert, I'm gonna shoot every known munition in the world at it, and if anything penetrates, I'm not buying it. Well, that's not how we fight tanks, or at least not how we're supposed to. We don't just send one tank out, we send a formation out. So now we want capabilities of formations, not capabilities of things. You put up the combat vehicle modernization strategy, the Hollywood Squares version. So what we've done with our combat vehicle modernization strategy is we say there's three main action figures in the Army, IBCT, SBCT, ABCT, Armor, Striker, Infantry. And we want that formation, the icon, to have a combination of mobility, protection, lethality, the formation. Okay. One way to get a combination of mobility, protection, lethality is a tank. That is all together, mobility, lethality, protection. But it may not be that way. You may provide mobility one way, you may protect the formation differently, and the lethality could come differently. So what we are looking at is capability documents for an icon, not a vehicle. The system doesn't, what do I do with this, Perkins? I get that all the time. You don't understand, that's not how this place works. Or we're saying, no, but we're gonna change that, because that's how we have to take a look. So then we break it down into pieces, and we say, okay, we're gonna take a look at all our action figures, the capability, not the thing. It's not a list of things to buy. It's a priority of capabilities to build. And we say, where's our lowest capability? Where are we most at risk? And actually, if you take a look at mobility, protection, lethality for these three, so you can see this, what you get with a former armor officer as a TRADOC commander. You don't get reams and reams of POM documents. You get a Hollywood Squares, okay? So that I can understand it myself. We say the biggest challenge we have in the Army is mobility for our IBCT, mobility for the 82nd Airborne, 18th Airborne Corps. Because what we have right now is our most deployable organization in the Army. Can deploy anywhere in the world just in time to reenact World War I, which means they can walk at 2.5 miles per hour and carry a rifle. So I'm a big first order principle kind of guy. So I said, you know what? One of the first order principle would be the United States Army should be able to move at least as fast as the enemy. So if the 82nd Airborne jumps in there, the enemy's driving around in Hilux pickup trucks, 30 miles an hour, I'm thinking we need to move faster than 2.5 miles per hour, because otherwise we are not much of a dilemma to the enemy. We will not get to a position of relative advantage. So what is the number one priority of our combat vehicle modernization strategy? Providing mobility to the 18th Airborne Corps. So I'm working with great American Steve Townsend and the folks out there. And I don't know if you're there recently there, we've got Razors there, we've got other things, we've got pilots going on, et cetera, like that, to provide them mobility. We're looking at other ways to provide them protection and lethality. Lethality will probably not be organic to this, but in fact, I have an AROC this week about another way to provide them lethality. So we're thinking very differently about this. So very interesting that having the TRADOC commander, a former armor officer, the number one priority for the combat vehicle modernization strategy is not a tank. It is mobility for the 82nd Airborne Division, because I'm focusing on capability for icons, because the Army fights icons. We don't fight individual things. So that's part of the problem of turning the system around to develop the capability documents to make them pertinent for the future that we have. So some of them that are 15 years old, we aren't going to do that anymore. We don't want to go down that road. We need to stop doing that, which is the only thing harder than starting something in Washington is stopping it. Okay? You have a program of record, and you try to stop that, what you find out is most programs of records are built in congressional districts. Okay? So when you try to stop that, there's actually all kinds of laws that prevent you from doing that. So we're having to engage a lot of our friends on Capitol and other places to say, look, if you want a high rate of innovation, this whole system is not designed to deliver that to us. But great question. It's an excellent question. So when I was in Israel talking to them, and we were kind of going back and forth, they said, there's actually a couple kinds of questions. A good question is one that generates thought, provocative, maybe a little confrontational, something like that. An excellent question is one that you already had the backup slide made for. So... thank you for that excellent question. Other questions? I think there was, yes, sir, yeah.
Yes, sir, Lieutenant Colonel Bobby Graves, Seminar 18. With the innovation theme of TRADOC and trying to bring that in, what are your thoughts or what initiatives for the new intellectual innovation? We still possess the Von Moltke staff design. Mm-hmm. Within our formations, but yet we've created the computer and probably went 12,000 times the capacity for computing power. So I guess that's my question. How are we going to leverage technology in the intellectual fight?
Yeah, so that's an excellent question. Put up the mission command slide. So when I said one of the things that TRADOC is for is to deliver .mil PF solutions to problems. .mil PF starts with the letter D, which stands for doctrine, okay? So this is now the Army's new command philosophy doctrine, how we're going to run organizations, sir, and it kind of gets to what you're talking about, our mission command. This is our command philosophy as well as a warfighting function. And this gets to this innovation thing, because when I grew up, the sixth warfighting function was command and control. Command and control was defined as command, issue an order, control, ensure compliance, the Von Mulkey method. I'm going to ensure compliance with my command to you, and that's why I will track. What we're saying is we still have command and control, so if somebody says the Army did away with command and control, that's not true. In fact, it's in this document, and it's bold and underlined. Okay, it's just that it is not the warfighting function. The warfighting function is mission command. And what mission command does is it balances command and control, not to ensure compliance, but to empower the initiative. That's what our doctrine says, is you need to figure out how that you empower, or how do you empower the initiative to get to a position of relative advantage. That is how you drive innovation. So we're not looking, because what's the worst thing you can do to generate innovation is redesign the staff. Well, you know, the G1's gonna work for the G2 or something. No. What we're saying is, this is all about, quite honestly, information flow. Information flow in decision rights. Two most scientifically proven ways to generate innovation. Information flow, decision rights. Because what the commander is supposed to do is drive the operations process as compared to attend it. Drive the process through understand, visualize, describe. Understand, visualize, describe. Then direct, lead, and assess. Understand, visualize, describe. Understand the problem. Exchange information. Visualize the solution. Describe it. It's all about information exchange. Understand, visualize, describe. All about information exchange. Direct, lead, and assess is all about decision rights. Okay? Doesn't say anything about motivators or reorganizing the Army or anything. This is an intellectual process that we are using to drive innovation. And so if you are in charge of an organization, if you are in charge of an organization, one of the things that you are for in that organization, as I tell folks, is you are the key understander and visualizer. That's what you do. I don't care if you're in charge of a staff section, a cubicle, a major Army command, or whatever. One of your jobs is to understand problems and visualize solutions and then describe it to people so that you get other people on board within and with outside your organization, okay? And influence audiences inside and outside your organization. I spend most of my time informing and influencing people not in TRADOC. I spend a very little amount of my time directing people in TRADOC what to do. Do this at Ranger School, do this here, do that. You know, I got tons of general sergeant majors do that. I spend most of my time informing and influence audiences, okay, and developing teams within and with outside my organization. Like I said, Friday I'll be at OSD the whole day. Tomorrow I'll be up with the Army staff. I spend most of my time engaged outside of TRADOC, informing and influencing them, understand, visualize, describe, and then building teams inside and outside the organization to increase information flow, figure out where the decision rights have to be so that we can increase our rate of information, rate of innovation. This is a very leader-centric process. It's exhausting. But it is the way I am absolutely guaranteed that you actually get innovation. This is, I believe, and I know it's a little parochial for me to say as a TRADOC commander, this is the right intellectual construct of how you run a high-speed, highly innovative organization to deal with this unknown we're going to come up with. You've got to constantly figure out how are you going to empower the initiative. How do you empower the initiative, and what is a position of relative advantage? Where do I need to be to get a position of advantage tactically, operationally, strategically, militarily, economically, politically? And I say relative advantage, and what is the implied aspect of that? That it's constantly changing. What's a position of advantage today may be a position of disadvantage tomorrow, maybe politically, economically, or whatever, even militarily. So you've always got to be thinking through that. Hey, folks, I'll leave you with one last thing, and I know I'm out of time. Put up the last slide, Army profession. So I'm going to leave you with this, Army profession. You hear a lot about it. We're ADRP1. I'm up here schlepping doctrine, the Army profession. A lot of people think, well, it's a mandatory training, 350-1. That's a problem with the Army. Can't handle mission command. That's a whole other briefing, mission command, mandatory training. Well, here what I'm telling you. Don't think of the Army profession as mandatory training, okay? It is the essence of who you are. It's the essence of who we are. And one of the examples I'll give, and the problem is the person that really pointed out to me was not in the Army and not even an American. It's actually when I was actually in Iraq working for the ambassador. So I was division commander over there and doing what division commanders do. I'm sure the ambassador wondered what the hell that was, but anyways, we won't get into that. And flying around with a counterpart, very senior to me, except like that, and we're doing training and equip and advise and transition reposture, whatever. And at lunch, so I'd been there a couple months, and at lunch we're sitting down, sharing a kebab, and I'm like, okay, sir, we're going to do this, and what we do this, and combined arms live fire and all that. And eventually I actually had reached the good idea cutoff point. He said, hey, General, stop. He says, you know, I've been watching you command this division for a couple months. And he says, you know, and you take being a division commander in the United States Army for granted. He says, I've been watching you. You take being a general officer for granted. I said, what? You're questioning the effectiveness of a promotion system that would select somebody like me to be a general? Get in line. He says, no. He says, no, I don't want to tinge my honor or anything like that. He goes, I've been watching you, and, you know, he says, you'll get in your fancy helicopter, and you'll fly up, you'll go see 1st Brigade, and you'll say, hey, 1st Brigade, I want to do this, and when you leave, you don't worry that when you leave, they're going to start a coup. And you go down to 3rd Brigade, and you give them new MRAPs, et cetera, and you don't worry that when you leave, they'll sell the MRAPs on the black market. Or you go tell the command sergeant major, hey, sergeant major, I want the NCOs to do this, and you don't worry that when you leave, sergeant major's going to call his cousin who's in the MOD and get you relieved, et cetera, like that. He said, you just blindly trust everybody. You are so naive, Perkins. If you were in our army, we would eat you for lunch. Because you just trust everybody that they're going to do what you tell them to do. You don't worry about coups or black market or anything like that. And I paused for a moment. I said, you know what? I mean, he's absolutely right. I mean, I didn't worry about 1st Brigade starting a coup. I didn't worry about 3rd Brigade selling their MRAPs on the black market. 4th Brigade, I kept an eye on, but I have reasons. He said, the other thing is, you know what? Your organization is kind of self-correcting. That, you know, if a private doesn't know what he's doing, you know, NCO steps in, kind of corrects him, lieutenant, maybe brand new, company commander gets him squared away. He says, what you don't understand, he says, is that I watch your division, and when things are going right, they like fix themselves, and you're not even there. What he was saying is, nothing happens in my army unless I am there. Things don't fix themselves. I have to go there and make it happen and keep my eye on it. But he says, things happen all the time, and you're nowhere to be found, okay? And he said, and then recently I was up north in Mosul, and you had an artillery unit, happened to be an artillery unit, not just because of the picture, and they were doing counterinsurgency one day, and the next day they transitioned to a live fire over dismounted infantry, firing howitzers over dismounted infantry, combined arms live fire. He says, so they went from one complex mission, counterinsurgency, to another complex mission, you know, combined arms maneuver, and again, Perkins, you were nowhere to be found. I don't really know what you do. In fact, there were hardly any officers there. It was mainly NCOs running the whole thing. They went from one to another. And the other thing is, your unit, your soldiers, tends to have a sense of something greater than what they are about. It's not about, you know, my allegiance is to the family or religion or something like that. He says it's about service to the nation. Their biggest concern is that they let their buddy down. He says they have this sense that they owe it to their organization to perform. You know, again, in the Army, we have a definition of esprit de corps. It has nothing to do with T-shirts and organizational days and runs. That's all great. But the U.S. Army definition for esprit de corps is defined as a jealous regard for the honor of your unit. A jealous regard for the honor of your unit is the way you are acting, displaying not only a regard for the honor, but a jealous regard for the honor of your unit. So when somebody comes up to me, hey, sir, our unit sucks, we have bad esprit de corps, I say, that's a personal issue. Because the esprit de corps is a reflection of your behavior, is the way you act showing regard for this, for this, for this. When somebody looks at you and say, you're an American soldier, you are giving honor to your country. You are giving honor to your army. That's what esprit de corps is, a jealous regard for the honor of the unit. The last thing is, he said, where do you get these soldiers? They will travel thousands of miles away from home and give their lives for people they don't even know when I can't even get my army to defend its own country. So what he said is, Perkins, I don't need you to lecture me. If I had an army like yours that had this, anybody can command an American Army division. I mean, you don't really do anything because you got this. He said, you have a huge problem, Perkins. You have a huge crutch. See, you lean on this every day. You have a substance abuse problem. If you don't get your fix every day of the profession, you're going to crumble like a house of cards. And you know what? He was absolutely correct. I completely take this for granted. I lean on this every single day. I take it for granted. I trust everybody, you know? I think everybody knows what they're doing. Esprit de corps is the essence of who we are. I just take it for, I say, that's the environment I live in. That's why I'm going to create a high rate of innovation. That's why, Sergeant, take all this stuff and fix this problem with UAVs. I'll be back in a week. Because I trust you. I know that you have a sense of duty, and I know that you're a pretty sharp kid. And that's why I can do that. Do you think this guy could give a bunch of stuff to one of his sergeants, say, I'll be back in a week and solve the UAV problem? He'll come back and everything's gone. Okay? Because he doesn't have one of these. And in some ways, he said, you know, it's kind of like a bait and switch. Because as you came over here and you sold us your stuff. We bought your tanks, we bought your rifles, we bought your Humvees, but they don't do anything. They just sit there in the motor pool and rust. They don't do anything. You know why? Because we bought your stuff, we just haven't built the capability to it because you didn't sell us this. And I've looked on the FMS catalog, and apparently it's not for sale. You don't sell it. You know what? He's absolutely right. Because this is a homemade deal. This is a do-it-yourself project. This is, you build it yourself. You build this yourself. And last month, 14 June, was the anniversary of the United States Army. Okay, 241 years old. So I remind folks, the birthday of the United States Army is 14 June, 1775. The birthday of the United States is 4 July, 1776. The United States Army is 1 year older than the United States of America. The army that your soldiers serve in is older than the nation they defend. Okay? And so we've been working at this thing for 241 years old. For 241 years now. The problem is it's taken us 241 years to build it, but you can lose it like that. Because how did we build it? Soldier by soldier, sergeant by sergeant, lieutenant by lieutenant. And how do you lose it? Soldier by soldier, sergeant by sergeant, lieutenant by lieutenant. So you want to know what you are for in the Army? This. You are the steward of the secret sauce of the Army. We can have whatever concept, doctrine, helicopter, thing, whatever we want. This is the secret sauce of the United States Army, and for that case, the United States military. And that's what you are for. You're about to become War College graduates. You are the steward of this profession. You're about to become a senior leader of the Army, and we are going to give you this do-it-yourself project that we've been working on for 241 years and say, it's yours now. You are a steward of this. Don't take it for granted. Thanks a lot, folks, and God bless. Sure.